Sarin, you can start.
Yeah, Miss Veena, shall we begin?
Yes, ma'am, yes. Ma'am, shall I start? Good morning, one and all. It's a privilege for me to welcome you all to the webinar conducted as a part of centenary celebration of Union Christian College, Department of Zoology and Department of Biosciences of UC College jointly organizes this webinar on topic Engineering Microbiome for Human Gut and Plant Root Health. We are fortunate to have an expert in this field, Dr. Hamid Abi, who is Associate Professor of Microbiology at Osmania University. So, without further ado, let's begin our session by seeking the blessings of God Almighty by a silent prayer. Now, I welcome Dr. Shyam Mohan to welcome the attendees.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome all of you to the popular website science webinar talk today. And as our college is celebrating its centenary year, we have been in the process of conducting various workshops, seminars in the online mode. And today, the Department of Biosciences and the Department of Zoology are co-hosting a webinar, a lecture on the engineering microbiome and plant root health. And we are fortunate to have Dr. Hamida B from Osmania University amongst us to share her ideas on the same topic, and she'll be the resource person for the day. So without further delay, let me go on to my job, and I would like to welcome all of you to this program. Firstly, I would like to welcome the principal of the college and the manager of the college in their absence. They have been constantly helping us out in delivering programs of the highest magnitude, and today is one such program. I welcome the principal and manager to this program in their absence. Secondly, I would like to welcome Dr. Susan Epen. Susan Epen, ma'am, has been constantly monitoring our process of conducting workshops throughout the pandemic. And today, it's a different topic. The first time we're having something associated with gut microbiome exclusively. And I thank Dr. Susan Epen for organizing this program and motivating us to better ourselves by conducting programs of this sort. I welcome Dr. Susan Epen, ma'am, to this program. And today's program is co-hosted by the Department of Biosciences and the Department of Zoology. And I would like to welcome Dr. Shirley Thomas to this program, who has been my teacher and constant inspiration. And she, along with the Department of Zoology and the Department of Biosciences, together had been coordinating some programs lately. I welcome Dr. Shirley Thomas to this program. Next is my opportunity to welcome the coordinators of the program, and Dr. Sarin Sarah John, ma'am, and Dr. Revati from the Zoology Department and the Biosciences Department. And today's resource person is Dr. Hamida from Ohio University. She will be chief resource person and engage in discussions and deliberations with reference to the gut microbiome. And the gut microbiome has been associated, we have had one seminar in which there was the anxiety component associated with the gut microbiome that was discussed earlier this year. And that program was definitely a source of inspiration for some of our students to undertake projects in that particular field. And today we will be looking forward to Dr. Hamida B engaging us with more prospects associated with the gut microbiome, specifically in a time where there has been excessive use of antibiotics, and there's always the talk for probiotics that is coming into the foray. So all of us are eagerly looking forward to the talk by Dr. Hamida B. We are fortunate to have you here, and I especially welcome the chief resource person, Dr. Hamida B, to this program. I hope all the students have a fruitful session here, and let me take the opportunity to welcome all the staff and the non-teaching staff of the Departments of Zoology and the Department of Biosciences, as well as the opportunity to welcome all the participants of the seminar from the college and from outside the college and from various universities outside the state. And also the technical part, with students who are comparing, volunteering for the success of this program. I welcome one and all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So before we start, let me explain to you how you could interact with us. You can type down your questions in the chat box during the webinar, and we'll answer all the questions at the end of the session during the Q&A. So now, I invite Dr. Revathi V.S. to introduce the speaker of the day.
Good morning. It is my pleasure to introduce our chief guest, Dr. Hamida B., Associate Professor of Microbiology, Osmania University, Hyderabad. She is awarded her PhD from the Department of Microbiology, Osmania University, Hyderabad, and she worked at the International Crops Research Institute for the semi-arid tropics. She pursued her postdoctoral training to generate transgenic groundnut to combat aflatoxin contamination at the ICRA-SAG. It is funded by DBT, Government of India. Her postdoctoral fellowship by NCRC Discovery Grant Canada and worked on the biocontrol mechanisms of Pseudomonas at the University of Manitoba, Canada. And previously, she has worked as lecturer at Mumdas Degree College for 3 years and as a visiting scientist at the ICRA-SAT for 2 years. And her main research areas is on plant probiotics and postbiotics to enhance the soil fertility and plant nutrition. She published 31 research articles in peer-reviewed national and international journals. She is a reviewer of many national and international journals, editorial board member of scientific international journals. She received so many awards like Young Scientist Award by the Association of Microbiologists of India, an ICIR Best Thesis Award, Jawaharlal Nehru Award for Postgraduate Research in the Field of Crop Protection. Recently, in 2018, she received the Asian PGPR Research Appreciation Award. In 2019, IWSA's Nani Gurnami Award for the Best Oral Presentation in the 14th National Conference of IWSA. And today's talk on the topic, Engineering Microbiome for Human Gut and Plant Root Health. Madam, please.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am, and a very good morning to the respected senior members, faculty members, and the coordinating members, and my dear students. I mean, I would take 2 minutes just to go ahead with the sharing of the slide, and then, yes, Susan, ma'am, I mean, you're able to see the slide?
Yeah,
it's in the slideshow mode, right? Yeah. Very good morning to all of you, and thank you, Susan ma'am. Like being part of IWSA member, I got invitation from Susan ma'am to address the youngsters, that is the students, and I'm happy mostly to interact with the young researchers, and I have worked on the plant root health for more than 2 decades now, and being a microbiologist, I mean because the research on microbiome goes parallelly for the human health, there is a concept on the human microbiome and also on the plant microbiome, so I try to add the things and also the prospectives, and am I audible, ma'am? I'm getting some disturbance. Is it fine? Shall I continue? Yeah. Sorry. Okay. So we are going to discuss about engineering microbiome, both for human gut and plant root health. And this slide is like for the students and the young researchers. You might be wondering, like, because most of you are biologists and also biotechnologists, is this content important to us, and how can this information be useful to us in the existing world, and how we can take forward this research concept. So I would brief up this with putting forward the explanation of the Bloom's taxonomy, explaining that this content, when I explain about this content, whatever you can think about the topic or the information or the given to you, you try to review the information, and at the same time you try to analyze it and evaluate it, and take forward the basic skills to the research skills, and also I mean, along with the basic skills to the application part, along with using your, the skills of how you can put your, these things into the research part. Whatever the information will be shared to you, just try to remember it, because most of the terminology, what I put forward may come from the microbiology and especially for the undergrad students, I would say, don't think like many of the things, we still do not know, but try to remember those things, make a review of those things, try to understand, or whatever the information or the literature or the prospect put forward to you, try to interpret. Like, as I think one of your faculty members said that you already had one microbiome lecture and many of the students have taken up the project based on that, and that too, again, we are because of the ongoing pandemic, we have a lot of people who have suffered or are taking a lot of drugs, so it becomes very much necessary to understand the microbiome concept. So try to understand it, and also you see how you can implement it and come to an analyze part, like how you can organize the things, how you can compare your research data with the existing literature, and that should be giving you the concept of hypothesis. So whatever the information that is given to you, if you take it in the form of knowledge, try to identify that, what is the problem there, or what is that you can think of working or planning for the research. Have a basic concept of that, and focus a little bit on the new task, because we are all biologists and science students. In science, we always look for the new things, again with a logical explanation, and put forward your innovative thought. And because these days, even if you are a biologist or a person with informatics, either it is bioinformatics or chemi-informatics, or you, even if you say you are from computers, your specialization is from the software. What basically we are looking is, we are looking for a useful prototype or product. No longer we are looking for the research that is basic and that retains in the lab. So the concept of how that basic research can move in the form of innovation to a prototype is the need of the day. So with these things, I want researchers to have, motivate them and try to, when I'm trying to teach something, I also want you to learn, think, understand, because this should be the, for the younger minds, you should get some thoughts of how you can sow your research ahead. Okay, and as biologists, we can surely do a lot. And I will explain part of my talk will be speaking a bit about the microorganisms. I know all of you know about the microorganisms, little bit, whatever, I'll try to add, based on what I mean, a microbiologist, like, and language of the metagenomics. If the term is new, as I said, just review it and recall it. With time, you'll understand it. And I'll give a glimpse, because the microbiome is a very huge project and a lot of research is done on that area. I cannot give the whole thing in a short period of time or in one single lecture. So I would say it's a glimpse of the microbiome. And now what strategies have come up? Because I would say, again, it's like nearly 2 decades of work on metagenomics and microbiome. And now people are looking for what alternatives they can do with the results obtained from microbiome. So that is how the strategies of engineering the microbiome have come up. With view of human gut and also the plant health. I would very briefly speak a couple of slides on artificial intelligence, because these days we are speaking or listening so much about machine learning and deep learning. So as biologists, do I still need to know something about these studies? So I'll add a little bit information on that. And as I already said, because of the ongoing pandemic, does our microbiome have an effect, or it helps us to build our immunity strong? So as the slides will be going down in the same manner I just mentioned. So if I have to define a microorganism, like what are they? They are single-celled microorganisms, and mostly you need the microscope to see. And they are like bacteria, fungi, virus. And in this, if you look at these things, we need a microscope. We also have, this is the name of the bacterium. If somebody, is the first time listening it, Escherichia coli. We have bacteria that makes us to digest food. We also have the same bacteria, but the strain will be varying, that can make us sick. So we also have bacteria called as streptococcus that are responsible for the sore throat. Like that, we have microorganisms, for example, say bacteria, which are good as well as bad. So mostly we would be focusing on the good when we speak about the healthy concept. and the comment, the contribution, or the, I mean, like you can say, the person who was behind the making of the microscope and to understand about these things, Antoni von Leeuwenhoek. So this is how the unseen world, I mean, has been started. Though he was not a microbiologist by profession, and he was a cloth merchant, but his understanding the quality of the cloth made him to make the different lens, or he ground lens, and that is how he has added, or to the, you can say, the invention of the microscope, and that is how we have a lot of information available today about the microorganisms. So if you look for the function, we have the bad microbes, I already said that they cause disease. We have the good one, they help us to stay healthy. When I say unusual, even in the extreme environment, say it is, any ice glacier, or even in the Himalayas, people have isolated the microorganisms, and which can consume, that is whatever the waste materials and all those things, and making of hydrogen gas, making of biofuel. Everywhere you touch, anywhere on the surface of the planet, and from the air to the water to the soil, everywhere these microorganisms are present, and they have diversified functions, and that add a lot to for us to make necessary that we understand about the microorganisms. So I simplified again for somebody to understand what could be the microorganisms that are good. So I think all of us know about curd, dahi, and I think the South Indian name, we call it here in Telangana as perugu. Mostly the doctors, they recommend us, whenever you are on antibiotics, take some good buttermilk, or take some curd. So that is also the reason, because these foods come with the own natural microorganisms or natural fermentation. So that is how we have good number of microorganisms or good bacteria present in bread or in the curd, and even for the leavening of the bread also microorganisms are used. Even for the fermentation of ethanol, the microorganisms are used. Even in the plant growth, there are microorganisms. So when I speak about the bad, naturally bad, whenever how we say in the, they are good people and they are bad people. So bad microorganisms make us sick. They result in the disease. It could be the diseases for the animals, humans, plants, and they also spoil the food. Even in when it is fresh, it is good to eat, but if you just do not take proper care and leave it, there are microorganisms that are naturally present, or in the air or in the source, wherever the food is present, it makes it contaminated, resulting in food poisoning, and again that also leads to certain infections. In addition to this, the wound infections are also because of the bad and the pathogenic microorganisms. So when I'm speaking about so many goodies and baddies present, now where they are present? So though I'm sitting in a room in the, along with the laptop just in front of me, on my laptop and on my hand, there are many present, that is billions on and in your body. The pen you use, the mobile you use, the anything, either it is the, any device you are using, or even a small paper you are using, or even spectacles, if you do not make it, clean it properly, there are many microorganisms present on and in our body right now. So again, explaining to the students, if I want to isolate them, or I want to see how does a bacteria look in a plane. So I have to make the cultural conditions, that is how, we need food to eat, for our energy levels. Even the microorganisms, when we want to culture them in the lab, in the culture in the sense, grow them in the laboratory conditions, there is you need a petri dish where you can pour the medium. The medium is nothing but we give certain carbon source, nitrogen source to the microorganisms. And because I want to see them, there is a solidifying agent called as agar. And we add it, and we take whatever source. It could be the soil sample, it could be the water sample, it could be the food sample, where I am assuming to isolate the microorganisms. I can go back and give it the proper temperature, pH required for the growth of that bacteria, and I can culture the microorganisms in the lab. Okay, this is fine. That is how I can culture the microorganisms in the lab. And this is, you might be thinking this is some art or rangoli. I just wanted to say that whatever you are seeing are nothing but the different petri dishes with the beautiful bacteria sitting there. And as this is online presentation, and I can't ask you any questions, so it will be mostly one way or monotonous. So I would say that anything that comes to your mind, jot down so that we can have a discussion at the end of the session. So you can see here, this, the world of microbiology is full of unknowns and uncertainties. Why I'm using this word unknown and uncertainties? Because whatever we know is very little about the microorganisms. So this is how, I mean, people with the arts and art and scientific, I mean, scientific skills, when they want to get art and science parallelly, this is how the things bloom out or come out. This is how the bacteria, you can see, they bring art to the life. And this is actually also done a part of American Society of Microbiology. And even in India now, many of the societies take up this Petri Agar art as a competition to motivate the younger students so that they can come out with their scientific as well as the artistic skills. So what we are able to see is the Petri Agar art, and it is couple of the images are taken from the ASM Petri Agar. I mean, every year, I mean, it's like conducts the thing, and some students who have the artistic skills can think of this. And this is one of our Indian student from, Sai Shirdi College of Anandpur. I mean, he has won the, I mean, second prize for making of this peacock. And whatever are these seen are all pathogenic bacteria. And you can see unity and diversity, how people focus on these things. There are a lot of images. If somebody is interested to know, you can just browse the Petri Agar art, and you'll get a lot of, artistic things coming out. Now, understanding that they are microorganisms, we can culture them in the lab. I mean, just trying to understand what is this culture dependent versus culture independent method to identify or to analyze the presence of microorganisms. See, if we are planning on ride on a ship and all those things, and there is an ice glacier that is visible, the person or the engineers can very well plan that, how from far they can visualize it and they can change the direction. But you also have to have an idea about the glacier of ice that is existing beneath, which cannot be seen. So when I say about the culture independent microorganisms, so I would say because these microorganisms need, first of all, a microscope to see. And how many of them we can isolate them in the lab or culture them? Why? Because we should know the food needed by all those microorganisms. So this is how, this study of unculturable or uncultivable microorganisms have taken up, and the terminology has given up as the metagenomics, that is presence of the nucleic acid or the nucleic acid components. And this metagenomic study have explained that only the nutritional requirement or lot of research, whatever has been done in the microbiology, we are able to only understand that there were 1-3% of cultivable bacteria and rest all are unculturable. So what do we want to explain here? Microbes, many microbes have never been grown or cultured in the lab because maybe we do not know the nutritional requirements of those microorganisms. So this gave us to the explanation that how microorganisms can be, or how unculturable microorganisms exist in the environment. And this is, defined as metagenomics. What does it mean by metagenome? It is a collection of the genes sequenced from the environment and that could be analyzed to understand about the genome. And the contribution, you can say, that is what I was saying. It's nearly 2 decades of study on metagenomics, and we have a lot of information on this. And previously, we were thinking microorganisms are cultivable. I can see them in the laboratory conditions. But this metagenomics and the contribution by Joe Handelsman has resulted a lot on the microorganisms, which cannot be cultivated. So this becomes an approach to understand the different microbial communities. We are not speaking about one bacteria, two bacteria. We are speaking about the communities. So that is what I was trying to explain, that this metagenomics, it bypasses the need for isolation and cultivation of the microorganisms as individual species. And around 1-3%, literature says 1%, sometimes even 3% of the microorganisms are culturable. Rest 99% of the microorganisms, they are unculturable. That is, we do not know. They are existing in the environment, but we cannot isolate them in the laboratory conditions. So what should we do? Take any source of sample, though I have given the example of the flowchart explains how a metagenomic study will be carried out. It could be the soil sample, and it could be compost sample, it could be the water sample, any sample, wherever you have, you take the, this particular soil sample. And if you go with the serial dilution method and the plate technique, you will get these microorganisms coming out in the plate. But what I would do is, I would separate the soil sample and going for the nucleic acid purification, separate all the other fractions, humic acid and all other protein components. I directly go for the nucleic acid separation and I can go for the sequencing analysis and make a assembly of that genome and understand what microorganisms were present in that particular sample. So this is how extraction of the DNA, whatever be the source, Okay, it could be a gut source, it could be a water source, it could be an insect gut, it can be a plant rhizosphere, it can be anything, it could be a ocean sample, anything. You go for the extraction of the DNA, and I'm not going much into the details, that is understand that. May use a method or the technique available, sequence all the genes present, and you will get about the metagenomic, or you can say about what different type of microorganisms, and then you have to assemble this data and relate it to the context and explain what different taxonomical units of microorganisms are present in that particular source of sample. So it looks almost like your printer. This is the machine used for the sequencing of the nucleic acid, and lot of versions, or how with time people have the sophistication and the easiness on the this this technique also has come out. So once again trying to explain you the overview of the metagenomics. As I said, the sample can be anything, a gut source, a insect gut, a soil, anything. Assume there are a lot of microorganisms sitting there, and because we do not understand the cultivable methods, I would go for the purification or extraction of the DNA, sequencing, as I just said about the any sequencer can be used, go by the method, any method which is available and which gives you, it should be giving you more than 90 to 95 or 98% appropriate sequencing information, and then you have to assemble that sequence, and then that assembled sequence will be, which is necessary for me to have a conclusion, feed onto the system and annotate the results of what the metagenomic sample consists of. So having said that, there is metagenomics, and we have microorganisms which cannot be cultured in the lab, and taking the DNA sample, we can correlate the diversity or the community of the microorganisms present. Parallel research was also going on the human genome sequence project. And as I said, though the journey was started to 20 years, if we look back in the year 2000, the cost for the genome was very huge. If you look back into Google and somebody is interested to know about the human genome sequence project, it was $1 million project. But as the time came down, the technique also has, the sequencing cost for genome has gone down. So that is also the reason people are doing sequencing of n number of samples. But still, any technique, it also always comes with limitations. We have to be very clear when we go for the DNA purification techniques. So I already said about sequencing, which data to be removed and which data to be retained. So that is also the very important part. And we have a lot of data available. This is how the informatics come into picture, and how we need the artificial intelligence or the machine learning also to analyze much about the data. So this information or metagenomics, people have worked parallelly on the human microbiome project. First, it started with the human genome project. Slowly it moved to the microbiome. I'll just tell you what is the reason. People are trying to sequence the different soil samples. It's called as a Terra Genome Project, and also sequence the oceans in order to understand the microbial diversity of the microbial communities. So to come back to the human genome project, again, it itself is a different thing to explain. But I would say that people were trying to understand the different diseases, and if we sequence the human genome, we had the interpretation that we would be having answers to many of the problems, maybe where we are not having either certain diseases or certain infections where they were not having the clarity about the curing of the diseases with the drugs. So it was a very long, more than a decade, the project has been taken and hugely funded, and it took nearly more than 13 to 15 years to get the information about the human genome. And if you look back into the literature at the NCBI on the PubMed hit, how you can also see, I doubt if the slide is not clear, we started it around 1960s, and how the microbiome research has gone, arise, or you can say how it has been raised. So when I speak about microbiome, I'm not speaking about microorganism, I'm not speaking about one bacterium E. coli, one bacterium Streptococcus, I'm speaking now about terrestrial land microbiome, aquatic microbiome, aerial microbiome, plant microbiome, insect microbiome, animal, whichever is animal, and the human microbiome. In order to understand this, we also have a microbiome day, and you can become the ambassadors for this if you are interested, especially the biology students, because this tries to explain you, and you can, there are a lot of blogs which gives you the idea to how you can contribute yourself, staying at your college or staying at your university. And I also wanted to say, this is actually the bacterial biofilm that's grabbed from the surface of the tank and using some fish technique. And you can see here, the bacteria Neisseria, I mean, and Vellonella, many microorganisms which are in purple color and few which are in green color, they are streptococcus. So you can see this is the image on the surface of the tongue for us to analyze or understand how many microbes are sitting there. And this actually is one of the main thing, because most of us have, I mean, or you can say the kids have the habit. So you can explain to them. I mean, this art was taken to, for specifically for the students or the kids to explain that when they just, you use the fingers and the nose, and this was an art taken from that such thing. And it's not that all the microbes sitting here are bad. In here, you can see maybe few of them are good, because they are, I mean, you can consider this as a natural flora that is present inside the nostrils. So having said this, I want to say that we are not individuals, but rather it is explained as an ecosystem. That is, many different species and individuals are coexisting with us. So I'll again come back to a little bit of the terminology, especially for the students. So what is this microbiome? It describes the collective genome of our indigenous microbes. We have many indigenous microbes. Previously, we used to only explain to the students about the normal flora, but now we speak about microbiota. Okay, what are the indigenous microbes associated either with us or with the plant system? So this is how we have to understand the definition of the microbiome. It's a collective genome of our indigenous microbes. And it's also called universe, because the moment I say universe, you imagine like something, it's like big, the stars, the planet, the glacier, the Milky, everything. The moment the universe comes to your mind, that term, I mean, right from the school days, we are taught about this. So you will get a big picture. Similarly, when you speak about microbiome, I want you to have the picture about the community of the microorganisms that interact with us and how it contributes to our health. So a lot can be done. Okay, human microbiome, it's like a treasure trove waiting to be unlocked, and young researchers have a lot that they can use. And this slide is very small. I would not explain the whole slide. I just wanted to say that it is not just, 20 years back, discoveries have contributed. The discoveries from 17th century till date have contributed to understand the human microbiome project, that is a soil metagenome project, and also there is an earth microbiome project continuing. If somebody is interested, you can go on this thing. So you can see here how, I'll be explaining how the, healthy soils for the healthy plants and also for healthy humans. So this is an example about the human system, how the acidic pH in the stomach, the components of the duodenum and colon correspond to the different microbial diversity. Similarly, when you understand about the plant system, the soil, that is the rhizosphere, that is the root part nearby the plant, and we have the endophytic microbes, the rhizosphere microbes associated with the plants, and how they contribute to the plant health. So if somebody is, the conventional agriculture, mostly, for farmers, we recommend, the farmers are recommended for use of different chemicals. And at the same time, how the conventional agriculture and eating, I do not mean that the non-vegetarian food, that rich in meat. If you go for rich meat food and low salads, and again, there is some contribution coming from the food that has pesticide residues, that may result in a fragile gut microbiome. So that fragile gut microbiome can also affect the health. Similarly, if you take foods rich in organic materials, salads, raw vegetables, and you take pesticide-free food, it may result in the healthy microbiome. So we should see how taking microorganisms as biofertilizers, biostimulants, and how they contribute to healthy plant microbiome as well as good health for the humans. Some more additional facts where microorganisms are present. If the cow or the animals, they are the buffalo and all this, they're able to eat the grass, it is because the human microorganisms, they help in fermenting that fiber-rich food and help in digestion. Similarly, there is an example about the microbial community outside the shrimp, how it protects the eggs from the fungal effect. And if you speak about the marine microbiome, it produces most of the oxygen what we breathe comes from these marine microorganisms. So microorganisms have a significant role in agriculture to contribute to the plant health. Similarly, microorganisms are associated with the different prebiotic and probiotic foods and whatever we eat. So there are a lot of diversified microorganisms in the diverse diet we consume. And if you can see here, it says that the trillions of microbes are present in the human body. That is, suppose if you see that the body weight is around 50 kgs, it says that the gut microbiota or the microbiota weight of yours is around 2 kgs. And with time, people are assuming that microbiome, like how we say DNA fingerprint, microbiome can also become the unique fingerprint for ourselves. If you look for the how this perturbations, in the sense how disturbances have affected the microbiota. So previously in the pre-industrial era, you can see the, I mean, humans, they were having the, then there's some disturbance. Shall I continue? Yeah. So human and intestine microbiome. So you can see how because of pre-industrialization, how they were getting associated, and because they had less mobility, or maybe there was, nearby areas, and they were not processing the agriculture foods. So you would have, human intestine microbiome, then the fecal matter was, released inside the fields, and then you have the fecal microbiome, which is called as a night soil, and that used to get associated with the soil microbiome, and that later on would contribute again to the plant microbiome, and there was not much processing of the food materials, and also not dumping of the fecal matter into the sewage and drainage, and how previously not much use of the chemicals used to be used for the agriculture, but later on a lot of pesticides were used. So this also have been one of the reason that all these, when I say perturbations, many disturbances along with the anthropogenic activities and the lifestyle change that also might have resulted in the variation of the microbiome. And if we look back, our grandfathers or our great-grandfathers, they used to be even healthy at the age of 80 and 90. And these days, even the kids, they do not want to be, they get tired for the small activities. So maybe this could be one of the reasons that they healed, or if they, they could harness a good microbiome when compared to the present situations or present disturbances. And maybe a resilience is needed to get back that microbiota in order to lead a healthy life. So I would speak first again on the human gut health and then come back to the plant root health. Now, I already said about the human microbiome. We have a lot of microorganisms. Now we know how many are culturable and how many are non-culturable. You can see here, it's like a network. Many of us know about ResearchGate and Instagram, Twitter. So you can see here, our body is hosting 100 trillion of microorganisms. And these are a couple of images from the Petri art. So whenever you shake hand, that is also the reason in COVID, we are asking that you just say namaste and don't better shake hands. So this is how, the microbiome can shape the friendships or whom you are associated with. It will have an effect on the association of the microbiome. See this, we think it is crowded place, but we can still count. But the microbes sitting inside the gut, we cannot count them. So people, or you can say researchers, scientists said that this microbiota can be explained as a different organ or the last organ of the human body. Because previously, not much was known about this. And now understanding that 2 kg of our body weight belongs to the microorganisms, researchers or scientists said it could be the last organ that has to be characterized in the human body. So I was saying about the Human Genome Project that came with a huge cost, and people were trying to understand about the different infections, diseases. They thought the Human Genome Project will be the answer to many of the problems, but it says that even 10 years later, the progress is still a puzzle. Why? Because the human genome is also associated. Because there we came to know that our genome is having a lot of genes, genome from the microbiota or the microorganisms. So then it comes as, who am I? Always we use the term I. So you have to understand that we are not single. We have a lot of microorganisms, or you can say the microbial cells are 10 times more than the human cells in our body. So you can see millions of microbes per square inch in our body are present, and many different species on the skin, specifically on the patches, dry patches of the elbow and in the moist environment of the armpit. Wherever you think there are microorganisms present all over. So if you look, the microbiome genome is, like you can say here, 100,000, and the human genome is around only 23,000. So it is also called as the second genome or the last organ. So you can just see when our body cells and the human microbiome genes, so we have 23,000 genes that contribute to the body cells and 9 million genes that come from the microbiome. So this is how we have a huge amount of microorganisms associated with us and compared to the human cells. So these microorganisms such as bacteria, archaea, viruses, fungi, protozoa, elements, they are all known to affect the general health and also the homeostasis. So if we have to explain about the healthy microbiome, it's the host-microbe interaction, it shapes the reciprocal fitness and also the co-evolution of the microbiota and the host. So if you refer to the balanced host, that is healthy microbiome, we call it as eubiosis. And if it's a, because of taking of anything, it could be an antibiotic, it could be an infection, it could be a disease, the microorganism or the holobiont associated with us may be characterized or disturbed. The how we have the pathogenic microorganisms, and that term is called as the dysbiosis. Now to understand where the journey has become begun, so you can see here either it is the normal delivery or the C-section, how the baby has come out. It's similar to that, and is the baby on the breastfeeding or the formula feeding, the microorganisms that are associated with us change. So you can see here, once the baby has come out, the normal flora from the mother come to the baby. And again, as I said, even if it's a normal delivery to C-section, the number of microorganisms that colonize and harbor also varies. So we have from the infant to the toddler to adult, and how the type of food materials we take. Initially, is it breastfed? Then is it formula fed? The baby started taking the solid food. Because of some infection, you are given some antibiotic treatment. Sometimes you are not eating good nutritious food. And if you are healthy, then what is the microbiome? As the age passes, that is also the reason, the variation of the micro. You can see these are the different orders, firmicutes, bacteroids, actinobacteria, how their percentage varies from the infant to the elderly. So you can see here, if it's a normal delivery, what type of microorganisms pass on from the mother to the infant, and if it's a C-section, what type of microorganisms. Similarly, when the baby is 6 months, what type of microorganisms are present, and when they start taking them in adulthood, what different orders of microorganisms come in the colonization part. In addition, more than 10% of the small molecules in the blood also come from the gut microbiome. So having said about the network of the microbiome and the microorganisms associated with us, oral microbiome is very important. Most of us have the habit of sticking to one type of toothpaste and also use Listerine a lot. See, everywhere, any sample, or you can say any source you take, our own human system or the human body or even the surface, there are microorganisms which are good or bad. So even in your oral microbiome, you have bacteria that are good, that are responsible to help you. And at the same time, there are bacteria that are responsible for the respiratory tract infections, certain type of cancer, and also the arthritis. And you have to take very good care of your oral microbiome, because this becomes a way, or you can say this paves the way for the different pathogenic infections. So you can see here, if you do not have a good oral microbiome, people suffer from periodontitis, and even a couple of studies related how having the effect on the not good microbiome in the oral has leads to certain cancer and also certain diseases. So either it is the nose or the oral or the skin or the in the gastrointestinal tract or the urogenital tract, the microorganisms are associated with us everywhere. And this I already explained to you that the total weight of 2 kg is from the microorganisms associated with us, and 60% of the fecal content has the microorganisms. So how people understood it? People have done the metagenomic study of the fecal matter in order to understand about different diseases. So in addition to this, the certain abiotic factors also contribute for the microbiome that gets associated with us. So you can say here, 1,000 unique bacterial microbial species are present. I'm not even saying bacteria, because now we are speaking about bacteria, archaea, fungi, everything. So broadly, we call it as a microbial species, and they get affected by the diet. That's what I said. Are you taking good, organic, when I say organic, I mean, like, are you taking good fruits, good vegetables? I mean, or are you on some antibiotic because of some infection? So all these things will contribute to the microbiome and the variation in the microbiome. So if somebody is interested, you can understand about the different orders of the bacteria, the fungi, helminths. Previously, we did not know much about the virome, but now, the pandemic or the present pandemic have focused, or made us necessary to also understand about the virome associated with us. And a lot of research is also done in the viral microbiota that are present in our gut. So people have done the variation in the viral populations and also the human disorders. That is, when there is malnutrition, people have seen taken the fecal sample, then done the metagenomic study and seen the variation in the viral diversity. And if it's a Crohn colitis disease, there is some cordoviral richness. So this is how, the viral taxonomy and the classification itself is a difficult task, because these are all, we can explain them as a non-living. Until and unless there is a host, the virus cannot multiply, but still, there is a lot to understand about the virome that is associated with the humans. So the conclusions of the Human Microbiome Project, as humans, we are swarming in and around with the microbes, and they are complex ecosystems, and the variation is associated with the various health states. And is it possible to alter or restore the microbiome was the main thing that people were brooding out. And this is also how the study was being done. The metagenomic source of sample was done from so many males and females, and conclusion results are given in this article. I will not go in detail. I already explained about the human microbiome, a bit of the things. And you can see here, people who are obese and people who are lean, are the gut bacteria responsible? You can see, which population of bacteria is huge. And the balance of formicutes and bacteroids is responsible for making leanness. So that is also the thing you should be careful, that if you can change your food habits. So obesity means it doesn't, you might be thinking, I'm already obese, or in my family history, I'm already obese, I cannot become lean. That should not be the concept. You can see that if you can change your health style, when I say health style, your food habits, you are going to slowly change the microbiome. It may take some time, but you are going to change it and come back to the normal. So the gut bacteria are responsible for appetite, for dietary obesity. I just explain you about how they are responsible for the appetite. So you can see here, when I say healthy microbiome, I call it as health symbiosis. And we have diseased or the pathogenic microbe organisms. They may dominate for any reason. The type of food you eat, or because of the antibiotics, or because of the association. That is how you have pets at home, or you do not have hygienic conditions. Many factors contribute to the microbiome associated with us. And if the gut microbiota are not balanced, that is, if there is no eubiosis, it can cause many diseases like inflammatory bowel disease, autoimmune diseases, certain types of stress also is also because of the, dysbiosis or outnumbering the pathogenic microorganisms over the good ones. So you can see here, it says that gut microbiome analysis and interpretation. So though such thing has not yet started in our country, people are trying to map the gut in order to understand about health, as well as given specific or precision medicine is coming up because of the gut microbiome. So you can see here, it's called as the gut-brain axis, because the bacteria sitting in it is communicating with the brain. That is the reason also some few people have, or whenever we see pani puri, we can't stand. Similarly, somebody when they have a lot of cravings towards this, ice creams or sweets, because maybe the microbiome that has been changed because of the type of food you are taking, it gives certain signals to the brain saying, no, I want still jalebi. I do not want to have a control on my obesity. So such signaling molecules. So this is what it's called as the gut microbes, because of the signals they give, and the brain has a control over that. It's also called as a second brain. And sometimes the stress, the mood behavior is also because of the gut microbiome. So will they control our appetite and the dietary preference, or did we lose, that's what I already said, because of the perturbations, did we lose the diversity of the microbiome, what our great-grandfathers were having, or great-grandparents were having, and that is also the reason that these days we are suffering with a lot of different disorders and diseases. So you can just see an example. The person has gone to the hotel for ordering. Actually, he says that he wants to have a garden salad, but you can see the microbiome sitting there, it says, you have to listen, and we do not want any salad. We want Chick-fil's, or you can say, if I want French fries, or I want chicken fried things. So that is how the signals, I mean, it looks weird, but your brain listens sometimes to the signals that are coming from the gut microbiota. So that is how you have to have a control over the gut microflora. So this is explained actually as gut-brain axis. So certain hormones and molecules, like you can say gamma aminobutyrate and serotonin and dopamine, which are responsible for the different balancing of our happiness and also our hormones. Many of these things also come out from the, are produced by the different microorganisms associated are present in the gut. So the brain can modulate the composition of our gut community, because if we go on, they'll give certain signals, then the brain says, no, you're going to use all the fast foods. Then naturally, this is how the variation or dysbiosis may result. So you also understand that 95% of the serotonin that is contained in the gut, in the mucosa and the neuroterminals of the entire nervous system, and most of it comes from the gut microorganisms. So gut can also communicate with the brain. People have done these studies using certain animals have been used, and they suggested that the gut microbiota, it mediates and regulates the release of the gut peptides. So till now what I was explained was the gut and brain axis, and till some time we were thinking that lungs have been considered like they do not have any microorganisms, but again the metagenomic study has intervened and said that we do have diverse and dynamic communities of the bacteria, and that also could be the reason that people who have suffering from asthma or any respiratory infections could also be a contribution of the microbiota associated with the gut, because there will be gut microbiota and gut lung axis. So this I just explained. Few of us also suffer that there will be bloating after the meals, that the acidity is there, and sometimes we have lot of acne and mineral deficiencies. So this also could be because of certain microorganisms, bacteria such as Helicobacter pylori, which is responsible for the making of the ulcers and all those things. And this is how they dominate when there is imbalance of the good gut microbiota. So what could be the reason for the dysbiosis? You can say that overgrowth of the pathogenic bacteria or inhibition of the good bacteria, maybe based on the food materials you are taking, and sometimes translocation of bacterial products. Sometimes chronic inflammation is also there, leading to the tissue destruction. And there is also coming up the concept of leaky gut. That is how people also suffer from constipation whenever there is dysbiosis. So anything, as I said, it could be the journey beginning, that is how the infant or the baby comes out, the food habits, and how hygienic you are at home, and are you on some antibiotics or some, because of certain infections or some any disease. So all these factors can disturb the microbiome. In addition, the geographic location, because how we have the abiotic factors and the climatic conditions. So you can see here the people like African children, they have great proportion of bacteroids, whereas the Western lifestyle people have increased formicutes and gram negative. This is how it leads to the dysbiosis. Variation in the diet and also the type of food materials we eat also contributes. Antibiotics, any infection, the doctor, the physician recommends that you have to take, because it's already 2 weeks, three days, and you're not coming out of the infection. Either it's a throat infection or respiratory infection or any other disease, whenever you are on antibiotics, because antibiotic, what you take is not going to only remove the bad one. It is also having effect on that bad one, also many good ones. And that has to be balanced. That is also the reason doctors recommend us to take certain Sporolac tablets whenever they give us the antibiotics. So till here, I was just trying to cope up about the microbiome and the gut health. I'll also go a couple of slides through the plant microbiome and plant health, and then come down to the engineering strategies. See, if somebody has a very good idea about how the microorganisms contribute to the plant health, even like how we speak for the humans, we are now using the same definitions of prebiotics, symbiotics, probiotics, even for the plant system. So this is also my area of research, where I focus most on the postbiotics or the metabolites from the good bacteria that aid in the plant health. So, and when we are speaking about the plant beneficial microorganism, previously we used to speak about one or two cultures or consortia of cultures, but now again the metagenomic study has said that the air that is around the plants, the phyllosphere, in the sense the leaf sample, or you can say whatever is above ground, the endophytic inside the tissue, the microorganisms that are associated, nearby the root. Previously, when you used to do research, people used to focus only saying that rhizosphere contributes and classify or understand the rhizosphere microflora. But now people focus on all the microorganisms, or you can say the bacteria associated with all these sources, to understand the plant health or the crop microbiome, which again leads to sustainability or use of microorganisms in agriculture. And if possible, can we avoid or slow down the chemicals that are used in agriculture? So plants also evolve with the microorganisms, and we have a lot of things explored even in this area. And there is significant microbiome research to understand the different traits, how it, the microorganisms can contribute to the crop productivity under different biotic and abiotic conditions. So it is broadly explained saying that the exudates coming out of the plant system will recruit the good microorganisms so that the plant can stay or retain health. So we have to see if there is a pathogenic interaction, if it's a good interaction, and good interaction coming from the endophytes or the epiphytes, and certain root exudates, how they colonize or help good bacteria to come. And the, when I say bulk, there may be microorganisms just sitting in the soil. So any signaling molecules or any factors also comes from them. And that, this is how can we maintain the phenotypic plasticity of the plant and also the health. So if we can take care of the plant and their microbiome, we give less preference to the research on the agriculture system or plant. But one thing you should understand is, I was saying, whatever food we eat, again, that contributes to our health. So we have to see that we take the research on plant, or that is the health of the plant and also the health of the gut should be balanced. Then only we are going to have balanced life or balanced ecosystem. So to add on to the cultivable microorganisms, like if I want to use certain smart microbes which can boost in agriculture production, I would work on then giving the nitrogen nutrition to the plant, that is N fixers. It could be symbiotic and asymbiotic nitrogen fixers, and working on the microbacteria that can solubilize the insoluble nutrients, working on the microorganisms which can produce a chelate ion, and enzymes that can aid a role in inhibiting of the bacterial and fungal diseases. And also microorganisms, because when we want to use them in the soil conditions, we want also to solve the problems. That is because we have huge dumping of metals and a lot of aromatic hydrocarbons come into the environment because of using of different chemicals. So if we can use them, because these microorganisms, they are considered as the superheroes. They can transform any organic thing which cannot be easily degraded. So we also should look for the microorganisms that can reduce the heavy metals from the toxic to the non-toxic state, and can tolerate the different polyaromatic hydrocarbons and make them simpler and available. So these are all the in vitro techniques, in order to say, or the cultivable methods where the microorganisms can be used in the lab to explain their role in plant growth promotion. And now you can see here, it could be called, it's called as plant growth promoting rhizobacteria or plant growth promoting bacteria. And you can see here, there are good number of rhizospheric bacteria sitting, and certain root exudates. And the exudates may also recruit the specific type of bacteria that can come. So people are, and when it comes to again to the plant and the agriculture system, the lot of research is also done, in the engineering on the genetic modification. People are now focusing on the natural approach. That is, can we take the gene pool of the different ecological niches? Is it the seed priming or the seed health that will contribute the initial colonization? Or can we inject or spray certain microorganisms? Or do we need to, how the type of infection or disease the plant is suffering, can we create a super microbiome and recruit in a non-GMO type of thing to recruit the good microorganisms that can lead to improve the crop, soil fertility and also the crop yield. So this slide I have taken because we have some association with Dr. Reddy from Bioesthetics. So we are working, we are planning to work a little bit in that trend. So how the microbiome changes, can it be restored? As I said, from infant to the adulthood to the child and the adult, how the microbiome change, and with puberty or pregnancy in the woman, as our diet and the medical conditions, the pets in the home, and many more factors are to be investigated. So having explained that there is a lot of disturbance because of the either the lifestyle, the microbiome has been changed. So what we can do, you can just see here. So there is, if there is a disturbance in the microbiome, it leads to diseases, it leads to low fitness, low fertility, and it's called as the dyshomeostasis. What we are looking is, we want balanced microbiome composition for the plant health, animal health, as well as the human health. So what therapeutic approaches can be used? People are trying to alter the composition and activity of the endogenous microbiota, and through use of prebiotics and certain therapies, can we supplement the microbiota with natural or engineered microorganisms? And subtractive, where we do not want some microorganisms to get associated, can be eliminated. So these are certain therapeutic approaches or certain approaches used to engineer the microbiome. So I'll just go through a quick look about the strategies, or given they are well explained in these two articles. People are focusing on using the feed enzymes, specifically when it want to change or alter the microbiome of the animals, promote the gut health by altering the microbiota because of the using of the feed enzymes. Prebiotics are nothing but you can use any fiber materials. People are trying to alter the microbiome of the humans, because when they are given prebiotics, there could be selective fermentation to produce short chain fatty acids from the by the microbiome. And people have seen there is increased bifidobacterium and decreased Clostridium species. And similarly, if we can use probiotics, when we are taking good amount of probiotic food, it has rich composition of lactobacillus, bifidobacterium, saccharomyces species, that will help to restore the balanced microbiome. And probiotics, mostly doctors, or you can say the physicians, or whoever want to, recommending the engineering strategies, they combine prebiotics and probiotics together. And there is also one more thing coming up huge on the human diseases. We call it as a Clostridium difficile colitis disease, or Clostridium difficile infection. Whenever someone is on continuous antibiotics, we have diarrhea, or you can say they suffer from stomach upset. So people are saying that if they can take healthy individuals and understand the microbiota associated with them and make them into products, that is, they take the fecal sample of the healthy individuals and what microorganisms are coming out or what products. So they want to restore the healthy microbiome. Mostly it is done for the people who suffer from this CDC. And coming down to the plant system, people are trying to transfer or get associated with the root associated bacteria. That how we do the fecal microbiota transplant. Here people want to work on the from the rhizosphere, how many centimeters of soil can be taken and how much can be explored, and understand the microbiome, and then try to understand how that soil can be transferred in order to maintain a good microbiome. People are also working on the signaling molecules, that as I said, how the root exudates also help in the assembly of the balanced microbiome. So such strategies are used in order to have a good microbiome association. So I'll just quickly give example of how experiments are done in the lab. Microbiome for the healthy bees, healthy mice, and already I spoke a little bit about the fecal microbiome transplant and also about the healthy span. So you can just see here how the initial study starts, microbiome association before the selection. They just select few of the bees and allow them to mature and make a study on the gut microbiome. And then see with time who is having who is successful in having a good health, then selection of that microbiome of the healthy bees, and then transfer it to the new bees. When I say new bees, mostly these are grown in aseptic conditions, and they try to understand how the microbiome that has come out of the healthy bees is contribute to the health. So this is one example of how the experiments can be done, and this is an example of how there are different mouse microbiome associations. Then you can see they are little bit lean, these mice, and they are obese and they are normal. So the healthy mice and the microbiome associated with will be taken. And again, in all controlled conditions, the mice will be born, and we take the microbiome from them, inoculate, and make a study. That is, it's like just one or two cycles of study will not be sufficient enough. A thorough study is required to understand about the association of the microbiome with the healthy mice. So this I already explained how people are working on the microbiome-based products for the people who are suffering from certain infections and diseases and who are healthy individuals. So can we get an idea about the microbiome associated with the healthy individuals? And coming down to the again plant microbial strategies, we have to focus on abiotic and biotic stress tolerance and bioengineering of endophytes and also sometimes injection into the tissues. And we also have to identify the microbes with the key traits that can help in the plant to overcome, or you can say, any sort of abiotic conditions and influence the plant productivity and the physiology. So this is again the similar manner, how you can understand about the plant microbiome association, maturation, and understand the phenotyping in, because for the plants we have to see the how the flowering happens, how the yield happens, and take whichever are in the good condition and select the microbiomes from those healthy plants, and then again go and inoculate it into the plants which have been cultivated in the sterilized condition, and have a thorough check of the microbiome that is associated from the healthy individuals in the ones which have been cultivated in the sterilized conditions. And it's not only the cultivable and the microbiome associated, lot of work is also done on a synthetic approach, but I will not cover here. If somebody is interested, like how synthetic approach is also used for the engineering to improve the plant growth, you can just go through this article. Very clear information is available. I already explained you how the microbiome associated with the plants, or the healthy plants, contribute to the good health. So till now I was speaking about the microbiome and its effect on the gut health and the plant health. And see, previously we used to read a lot. Now with the technology and the networking, we have a lot of devices in front of me. So that is also the reason I'm sitting at Hyderabad and trying to communicate with, to the coaching at Kerala. That is how we are trying to use the technology. So with time, when we are harnessing the technology in that sense, you should also see how the machine language or using of the machines, can it decrease our work, and at the same time, can we get more information with feeding the data to the machine? For example, I would say, just imagine an apple to the students or in the class. Then all of us, the moment I say apple, the first thing that comes to the mind when we think is the red colored fruit, what we always have, and mostly now it's also the season for the apples. But when you just Google apple, what does the machine give it to you? Whatever we have feeded, when we say apple, is it the iPhone, is it the laptop, or is it the fruit? It gives a chance for each and everything and comes out. So that is how the machine learning can be harnessed or used in order to get multiple things in a short period of time. I just gave you a small example of why we have to think of using the machine learning in biology systems. So I am not even a good expertise here. I only take up these slides to motivate the younger students, because you have a lot of courses available online and where you can understand about use of AI. And you don't think now this is also the job of the software people to work on AI or machine learning, and they have to come back and work on the biology systems. You mostly, I would prefer for the undergrad students, you can think of using such courses so that you can solve or work on some problems, or troubleshooting problems, and maybe we may come to some conclusions. So all these three, explain the form of a figure or a diagram, how each things are linked. I'll just give you how in the microbiome, one example, so that you get some clarity of how artificial intelligence can be used in the microbiome related studies. Okay, so machine learning, it provides new insights, as I just said, development of models, predict outputs. We are already doing a lot in bioinformatics, to understand the drug design and the interaction, and how does the drug how it gets extracted, or how it gets absorbed, and how it is released. So certain type of things can also be used to understand about the metagenomics, microbiome, and the machine learning. So we are trying to train a computer so that we get the results in a fast manner. Like I just said example of the apple. So if you, if we give a juice for the student, even for the first time, if we are taking a new fruit juice, say it is apple juice or cranberry juice for the first time, we may not know. But if you give the same, the student is, this is orange juice, this is apple juice, cranberry juice for one time, and again you explain them, again after 1 or 2 days you give them, they will recognize. Similarly, the machine can understand what a healthy microbiome cluster looks like, because I am not, or we are not speaking about 1 to 100 bacteria, we are speaking of thousands and millions of bacteria. So clustering such data is not possible for the humans, or clustering such proteins is not possible. So we try to feed to the machine that, if we have this bacteria, it's a healthy individual. If we have put this bacteria, it's a disease individual. So that is how it lessens our system, and we have to use this. So you can see here, using the library and keywords, how you can short down the papers which are more relevant to you, and which can be used, and then article how it explains the machine learning in the human microbiome studies. So I'll just explain here about the cardiovascular disease and how machine learning was used to understand the gut microbiome based screening. So they have taken the fecal sample. Now I think all of you understand, when I say fecal sample, they are going for the fecal sample and the ribosomal RNA sequencing to understand about the microorganisms or the bacteria associated with them. How many samples you can say? They have taken 478 people with the cardiovascular disease and 473. This is the sample study done, one of the American Gut Project. And they have got the information that 39 differential bacterial taxa were identified between the people who had the disease and who didn't have the disease. So this is how it makes us an ease to understand about the microorganisms or the metagenomic study, getting the machine learning into picture. Yeah, this is almost coming to the conclusion. I think you should bear me for another 10 minutes. I'm almost done. So how good microbiome matters because of the ongoing pandemic. So we should understand, I already explained, you know, what are the prebiotics, what are probiotics, what are postbiotics. So how this happens or helps us in the well-being. Somebody interested can look onto these articles, how gut microbiome really contributes to good health. And is it that probiotics also can play a role? I'm not saying probiotics, if you take good food and good probiotics, even if you have COVID-19 positive, you need not take any drug. That is that should not be the outcome of the study. Taking good food along with the drugs recommended by the physician is also important to come out of the disease. So these are all the different bacteria that gets associated with the foods, and we need to restore or rearrange them. How do we get? Taking the fiber rich food, and if you have to do good exercise, and taking the bacteria from the healthy people, that is for the fecal microbiome transplant, take care of the home microbiome, that is maintain good hygiene. If somebody says you have dust allergy, major thing is maybe you are not having good hygiene conditions at the home, and that don't just relate it to the environment. Okay, are you having pets at home? I do not say that do not have pets. Take care of them, because the microbiome associated with them also comes back to us. So how prebiotics, probiotics and postbiotics can alter the gut microbiome has attracted the recent interest. So you can see here, are we looking for these burgers or french fries? Or the microorganisms associated with us are in the gut. What type of food they like? So what did we learn? That is, happy microbiome keeps us healthy. So you should see that you should have good food, food consumption in order to have your health in a good and stable manner. So these are all the definitions I already said. Contribution of prebiotics, probiotics, and now postbiotics is also adding up a lot in explaining about the human health as well as the plant health. So just to explain a little bit about how the probiotics, we are assuming, or you can say hypothesized, to combat the viral infections. So what you can see is viral clearance, it occurs in the lung and the gut epithelium, because we thought it's respiratory bone thing, but we are also having the thing that people with the COVID infections, they are also having a lot of stomach upset, or you can say because the virus is also able to is affecting the gut or the intestine, that is, it's able to go and colonize there. So if you take good food, and what, because it goes and colonizes and gut dysbiosis is created, if you take good food, we are assuming that that dysbiosis can be again balanced, and it can result in the homeostasis, and the immunity of the patient or the person suffering from the COVID infection will be protected. So you can also see that people who had respiratory illness, they were a little bit recovering, but people who had gut and respiratory illness, the population or the percentage of population was more, and the people who had digestive symptoms, or illness in the gastrointestinal problems, it took a little bit more longer time to clear the virus. So that is how, if you think that, I mean, somebody has an infection, or I mean, because we are again listening so much about the third wave and those things, try to say that if at all if there is a problem, try to do good, healthy probiotic and prebiotic consisting food, so that the because there is cytokine inflammation that is the main problem in the COVID infection, so that has to be controlled, and having the immune homeostasis is recommended by consumption of good food. So the gut microbiota and the human homeostasis seem to have back and forth relationship, and gut microbiota derived signals are known to tune the immune cells, thereby susceptibility to the various diseases. So that is how you can see here, having the immune homeostasis to having the good gut microbiota also helps us in overcoming the COVID-19 infection. So if there is an imbalance or dysbiosis, and that could also be the reason for the inflammation in the lung. Again, because I said there is gut-lung axis. How the virus enters and again affects the lungs, there is inflammation in the lung and it can affect the gut microbiota. So again, there is dysbiosis. Again, that can weaken our immune system. So we should see that unbalanced microbiome or dysbiosis can also establish an inflammatory environment, and the COVID strain or the coronavirus can exploit that, and it may lead to the mortality. So what's the gut feeling? Because the pandemic is still there, pay more attention to our guts and gastrointestinal tract. Stay home, stay safe. Whenever there is necessity, try to go out with regular hand washing. Eat well. I don't mean eat all the type of food. Eat good, healthy food consisting of probiotics, which ultimately contribute to the healthy microbiome. So having all the foods, prebiotics, probiotics, synbiotics, may increase our immunity and help us to resist the infection, and it may result in the faster or the recovery rate from any of the infections. It's not only COVID, but any of the infections. So I always appreciate the saying of Madame Marie Curie. Like she says, be more curious about ideas, because we want the younger generations to be more curious about their thinking, about their understanding, about their ideas. I would also say, be more curious about the microbiome. So you can see here, the mind is not a vessel to be filled, but a fire to be kindled. So I can take the questions, and I also have referred these articles. So I have taken a few of the information from the slide share from Google. It's always good to acknowledge the information taken, because we should not get associated ourselves because of the social networking. Few things we may have the copyright problem, and for teaching and learning we can use, but it's always good to cite the articles wherever we have used the information. So I'm done, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. The session was so informative, and you have explained a very complicated topic in a very simple way. So already we have a few questions in our chat box. Now anyone having any more questions could post in the chat box. So ma'am, one question is from Susan, ma'am. Yes. Which microorganism can be used to increase the yield of plants?
I cannot say about one microorganism, because now, ma'am, as I said, after this research of metagenomics, we do not want to focus on bacillus, or pseudomonas, or rhizospirillum, or rhizobium. I would say a consortia of them, whichever goes by the regulatory things, either in terms of biotic or abiotic means, we have to focus on that, because we are not now one-to-one. I'm saying it's a community, it is an ecosystem. So down the lane, if somebody is coming in the area of plant research or human research, don't focus on one or two microorganisms. So try to work on the techniques, because everything is available. The only thing is it comes with a cost. So we have to see that how we can work on, because though I say if I want to work on one or two bacteria as a researcher, the cost may be not much in the lab, but when I want to do a metagenomic study, it comes with a huge cost. So that is where we request the scientific funding agencies of Government of India to look focus on to this, but we have to see how we get more fund to do more research.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the second question is from Dr. Devi NP. The question is, some soil microbes are antidepressants also. What is the mechanism behind that?
Some soil microbes are?
Antidepressants, ma'am. Antidepressants.
Antidepressants. Yes. So, see, even it's not only... So, yeah. Anything, ma'am?
No, ma'am. My question is, what is the mechanism behind the antidepressant activity of the microorganisms?
Okay.
That's from soil microbes.
From soil or from the gut microbes?
Soil microbes. Microorganisms which are present in the soil.
Yeah, ma'am, what I want to say is, see, previously we did not have so much of sophisticated techniques. Either you take the analytical part. Previously, we used to do mostly with the HPLC, and now we have GC, HPLC, MALDI-TOF of analysis. So I would not say it's only the soil microbes, they have the anti-stress molecules or antidepressants. Lot of research is also done on the marine microbes, because if these are all fermentation metabolites, and these are all considered to be the, previously we used to call them as fermented products. And again, based on the upstream, what type of nutrients we give, downstream also varies. But it's not only the soil microorganisms have, the various microorganisms have various metabolites, and we need to harness them or harvest them to understand their application. I mean, either it is in terms of antidepressant, or it is in terms of anti-cancer, or it is in terms of antimicrobial.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Okay, ma'am. So we have a third question. And how will it affect due to prolonged use of such products?
Nisar, audio was not clear to me. Either you say it again or put it in the chat box.
Okay, ma'am. Good morning. I will read the question. Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay, I will read the question, ma'am. Thank you very much for your nice presentation. What about pre and probiotics in cosmetics and personal care products? Then how it will affect the health due to the prolonged use of such products?
Okay.
Thank you.
So prebiotics and probiotics in terms, because live microorganisms in terms of, because mostly when it comes to cosmetics, it is the yeast that is widely been exploited. So the metabolites and the emulsifying things are exploited, but I do not have much information about live microorganisms and their use in cosmetics. Maybe I need to check back again, because I did not get such question till now. And it's because it's a cosmetic microbiology, though I know that metabolites used by microorganisms in cosmetics. I mean, I do not have much information about directly. Do we have anything that, are there formulations with the direct microorganisms in the cosmetics?
Good morning, ma'am.
I think it is used extensively for the skin health, I think so.
Yes, pardon, sir?
I think it is extensively used for the health problems, the health skin. Health.
Skin is different, sir. Skin, I'm not saying. I'm saying, like, if you say cosmetics, it's a different thing. If you say wound infection, it's a different thing.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Excuse me, ma'am. Good morning. Yes. Thank you, ma'am, for the wonderful presentation. My question was related to plant microbiome. Ma'am, when you say plant microbiome, is it always the rhizosphere-associated microbes, or do you study those which are present on their surfaces, or as well as the endosymbiotic forms?
Everything, ma'am. That's what I said. If you ask for a research student, maybe they focus more on the rhizosphere microbiome, because it's, they get a good collection of the microorganisms with various traits. But if you want to evaluate at the crop microbiome level, we have to consider the phytosphere microbiome, the aerial microbiome, the endophytes, because now lot of research has also come up with the endophytes, because mostly for the abiotic stress conditions, we are saying endophytes play a significant role for the plant to overcome either it is a salinity stress or the drought stress. So we have to focus on each and every microbiota associated with the system in order to get a clear information.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, there is another question from Namira. What is the role of probiotics in treating a disease?
That's what I said, ma'am. We can say that it will aid in the, maintaining the homeostasis in the gut. Because, as I explained, most of the diseases, they start from the gut. So if we are not having, because we have a lot of molecules that comes into the blood also come from these microorganisms. So we have to see that when we consume these prebiotic foods or fiber-rich foods, when I say prebiotic foods or fiber-rich foods, and again, natural fermented foods, I would always say, specifically if there are any women in the group, I have seen many women in the group, I would say that specifically for the breakfast, how our parents or our grandmothers used to tell us that you have to eat this food in summer, eat this food in winter, focus a little bit more on that food also, because that will surely allow us or help us to retain or resilient the microbiota that was associated with our, either it's a parents or grandparents, and maybe we may help our children to not to succumb to the infections at a very early age.
Okay, ma'am. There is another question. Can the gut samples of earthworm be frozen dry first and then sent to company for DNA extraction and analysis?
See, I would say, you have to have a clarity. Frozening the sample may also help you it may disturb some of the microbiota. So the best answer would be from the company person. But I would say, separation of the nucleic acid, if you can do from your end, that would be more good. But if you do not have the facilities, you have to check with the company people how they need the sample. Because naturally, if you keep anything in the frozen, you are going to disturb the microbiota.
Okay, ma'am. There is another question from Anu. Can we make use of the bacteria present on mangrove pneumatophore for human and the growth of other plants?
Bacteria present on?
On the mangroves, mangrove pneumatophore, ma'am.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. See, microorganisms, they are ubiquitous. If you can take the bacteria there and work on the metabolites, that is one end. But at the same time, when you think want to use in agriculture, colonization of the bacteria plays a significant role. Either you do the seed priming or seed coating when you want to recommend the application at the in the farmers community and want to use those bacteria or microorganisms at the seed level. Those bacteria should be able to colonize, because colonized component is one important feature for the bacteria to stay there. Because again, otherwise, if it doesn't have those colonizing ability, it may be outnumbered by the other natural flora present there. So that has to be taken care.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. There is another question. Does depression could lead to the change in gut microbiota composition, or change in gut microbiota composition could lead to depression?
I would put in the other way, or the second part. So you try, if somebody thinks you have any sort of stress, if you ask me, I would say don't use the word stress, even to my kids or myself or anyone. Because see, it is how you take up. And at the same time, you take good food. Good food will naturally, allow you to have good microbial composition or microbiota, and you will not have any stress. If at all, if somebody thinks I'm not happy, I'm getting tired, change your diet at least for a period of more than 6 months. Changed my diet for 1 week, I have changed my diet for 1 month. When you change, be stable enough to change the diet. There is a marriage in the family, I want to go back and take all that fast food, or there is a gathering of the cousins, I will take. No. If at all, if you think that there is something I'm not having, there is acidity problem, there is bloating problem, or I am having some stress, you try to change that. See, I'm not again a nutritional person, but based on the literature available and based on my own information, or I can say, after reading this microbiota concept, what I did was I made my family members and myself a lot of fermented foods. So that could be one reason how we can help ourselves.
Okay, ma'am. There is another question from Jagannath. Urine therapy has anything to do with microbiota?
Pardon? First part I didn't get.
Does urine therapy has anything to do with microbiota?
I still didn't get.
Ma'am, urine therapy.
Can you just type that word? Because maybe the accent you're using I'm not getting.
Okay, it's ma'am. Urine therapy, madam.
Urine therapy.
Yeah, urine therapy.
Sir, I already told about the FMT, sir, fecal microbiota transplant. So again, the moment I say fecal transplant or urine therapy, in the conditions we will not be, happy to take. Again, it is an ethical issue, and many of them will not be happy. So I would say that having the microorganisms or understanding what people are trying in the fecal microbiota transplant is taking the microorganisms, having the cultivable thing in the lab, they are making or producing those microorganisms and giving in the form of tablets to the people who are suffering from the disease. So maybe in that sense, because again, urine also has the other chemical components in it. So I mean, I would say that we should have a more clarity, and because more pathogens also will be present in the, I mean, certain, because whenever we have the, any infection, because anything that comes, the urine sample may also have certain pathogenic bacteria. So a thorough study is needed before recommending any such therapeutic thing.
Okay, ma'am. There is another question from Deepa. Once if the gut microbiome is damaged by drugs or due to some disease, is it possible to restore this gut microbiota?
It is very much possible to restore. That is what I am saying. Take good foods. Surely it will help you. When I say good food, I am very clear, homemade food. Don't get the batter from the shopping mall or something, because any pre-treated food will lose, or you will not be harnessing the exact quality of the microbiota associated with it. So that is also the reason I was saying that women in the group have to take some initiative role in combating COVID-19. We also should do something back to the family. So it's not only I'm cooking all the time, it's not only cooking, cook and give more fiber food to the children. These days children, they do not like the fiber food.
Okay, ma'am. There is another question from Namira. Does microbiota has a major role in autoimmune disorder?
The studies are coming up. Because people are focusing more on the diabetes, cancer, and I can say is digestive, that is colitis, any intestinal disorders. I think there are reports. I would not say no, but most focus is on these three things. Because rheumatoid arthritis also, so a couple of reports are there, and certain autoimmune disorders also, that could, because even for asthma also people are coming out with the imbalance of the lung microbiota.
Okay, ma'am. There is another question from Nazia. Penicillium trichoderma is used to improve plant health, but they are mostly mycotoxigenic species which produce mycotoxins whose contamination in crop may cause health issues. So is it safe to use it to improve the health and yield of plant?
See, when I say about trichoderma or penicillium, mostly these are recommended from the controlling of the disease or from the solubilization of nutrients. One thing we should understand is we have various species of this genus, either it is trichoderma or penicillium. The species, we have to see that we use avirulent, that is non-pathogenic strains, or which do not, you can say that we have the strains which mostly produce mycotoxins and which do not. So we have to see when we use such things, we need avirulent strains when we specifically recommend to the agriculture board or the farming community. So there are species that vary, and few are good, and so as I said, goodies are there, bad are there. Escherichia coli, good is there, bad is there. So similarly in trichoderma also we have good, and we have one or two which are associated with the respiratory infections, and similarly even with the, not so many reports about penicillium, but trichoderma we have certain reports. So we have to look for the species which is not pathogenic in case of humans.
Okay, ma'am. There is another question from Dahlia. Do small RNA of plants have any role in human microbiome?
Small RNA. Maybe even I need to look back to the literature, because I did not go about the small RNA molecules. So maybe Google will be the best person to answer here. I have not looked back that literature.
Okay, ma'am. There is another question from Abdul Hamid. Any change in proportion of gut community in vegetarian and non-vegetarian?
See, conclusion cannot be made as such, but they do not say that do not go for the non-vegetarian food. Take non-vegetarian food along with the fibered food is the recommendation. And they say, because few people have the habit of only taking non-vegetarian food, naturally it will lead to the multiplication of the formicutes, or establishing or colonization of that group, that may lead to obesity. So we have to see that we take balanced, anything is balanced. Either vegetarian or non-vegetarian, whatever I say, take the balanced form of the diet to establish a good microbiome.
Okay, ma'am. There is another question from Sonia. Are we testing the impact of medical drugs on health of gut microbiota?
Yeah, a couple of studies are done with at NIN, I guess. And as I said, this research comes with huge money. So we have to see that a few of the central universities and NIN is working. But as I said, not all the things can be done at one time. It's very huge project. Lot of things can be done. Geographic location of the South and North Indian region also may matter in the variation of the microbiota. So you have to take many things into consideration whenever you want to do any such studies.
Okay, ma'am. Are there any more questions? Okay, so I hope there are no more questions. So thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for answering all the questions and for a very great presentation. So it was a pleasure to have you with us. Now I invite Dr. Sareen Sara John for a vote of thanks.
Yes, good afternoon, faculty, participant, Hameeda ma'am. Yeah, we have come to the end of this session. It was indeed a fruitful session on engineering microbiome for human gut and plant root health. And Dr. Hameeda B, she's the associate professor, as you all know, of University College of Science, Osmania University, Hyderabad. And she made a clear presentation, detailed presentation. It was crisp and clear, and she told us how microbiome is useful in the world. And she explained the language of metagenomics and microbiome and the journey through human and plant microbiome, everything in an excellent manner. And also she had gone through the artificial intelligence approaches and also considering the current scenario, that is microbiome and SARS-CoV-2, the fact that how microbiome can share friendship, that is also she has pointed out. And as ma'am told, there is a rise in the microbiome research yearly, and you have made a quote that microbiome is a treasure trove waiting to be unlocked. So we all are expecting. That's why we have got such an interesting and interactive session. Thank you, ma'am, for being with us, for spending your valuable time and valuable knowledge and sharing all the details. You have made all the details in a perfect manner, and I think participants have clearly benefited from this session. Thank you, ma'am. And I take the opportunity to thank our principal, Dr. Rina Rachel Phillip, and manager, Reverend Thomas John, in spite of their busy schedule, that's why they are absent. And they both support very much in our academic activities to a greater extent. Thank you, manager Achin and principal. And I thank my mentor, Dr. Susan Epen, our adjunct faculty. She provides us the best resource person always. She's providing us the best resource person, and she gives valuable advices in all our academic endeavor. I thank you so much on behalf of the department and the entire fraternity. I thank Dr. Susan Epen, ma'am, for giving us the best. And I thank Dr. Shirley Thomas, head of the Department of Zoology, and our academic dean for being a motivator and a guide and a supporter in all our endeavors. Thank you, ma'am. I also thank our head of the Department of Bioscience, Shyam Mohan sir, for being a catalyst that stimulated us to do the best. Thank you, sir. And I thank Dr. Revati, ma'am, for being with me as a coordinator of this webinar. And also I thank the faculty of Zoology and Bioscience Department for serving with me and for supporting in all the department activities. Thank you so much. And last but not the least, I thank the participants of the webinar, because they made the webinar very fruitful and they interacted with us. They are the constant supporters of the webinars. And I also, at this juncture, I also share that we are scheduling another webinar on 28th by Dr. Priya Abraham, Director NIV, on the 28th of this month itself. Hope to see all during this webinar also. Your constant participation is always solicited. Thank you very much for being with us. Last, also I thank my students and all my supporters. And thank you very much. See you all during the next webinar. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. The feedback form is given in the chat box. Please do fill the feedback form. So I thank each and everyone for being a part of this webinar. Thank you, Hamida ma'am, for such a wonderful session. So thank you, everyone. Have a good day.
Yeah, thanks, Susan ma'am.
Thank you, Hamida, for the excellent talk.
For interacting
with really come down to the level of students, you know. So you are teaching in Osmania and you could come down to the level of students.
Yes.
And I am sure that many of them will be motivated to follow your footsteps.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am.
Mesmerizing talk.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you for the role.
It is very much beneficial for the research career also, I think. Students are very much interested. That's why you have got very much, lot of questions also were asked by even students and faculty. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you,
so
ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Yeah. See you guys again sometime.
Yeah, thank you.
We'll be
thank
in touch. So thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye, bye. Bye, all of you.
കോവിഡ് ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു.